श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम, जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम,
श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम, जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम,
श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम,
श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो
श्री राम जय राम,
जय राम वो श्री राम जय राम, जय जय राम वो ओम श्री राम, जय राम, जय जय राम, हरि ओम टू एवरीबॉडी। डे बिफोर यस्टरडे व्हेन देयर वाज अ सिमिलर सेशन विद सम अदर फ्रेंड्स, इट वाज सजेस्टेड दैट वी शुड शेयर समथिंग अबाउट गांधीजी's वर्ड्स। Exactly before the session started, we opened a book called the In Search of the Supreme, a compilation of so many articles of Gandhi, and then just we casually opened. This language is not correct, but for us, you know, normally we say these words. God willed that we should open that particular page. And then when we came to know, he was making a reference about the first sloka of the Ishopanishad. And later on when we started going through it, we have to go through now, we find the essence of all that is to be known. To lead a peaceful, harmonious, spiritual life, to lead a successful worldly life, this particular mantra helps us a lot. It helps us to free us from so many delusions and illusions and try to connect us with the real owner of everything. We will just go through Gandhiji, some of the words of Gandhiji, and then see. Gandhiji says, let me for a few moments consider what Hinduism consists of, what it is that has sired so many saints, about whom we have historical records. Why has it contributed so many philosophers to the world? What is it in Hinduism that has so endorsed its devotees for centuries? Did they see untouchability in Hinduism and still enthuse over it? In the midst of my struggle against untouchability, I have been asked by several workers as to the essence of Hinduism. In other religions, there are so many. Here we have, have we not, something that will answer the demands of the most philosophic among the Hindus, or the most matter of fact among them. Some have said, not without good reason, Gayatri answers that purpose. I have perhaps recited the Gayatri Mantra 1,000 times, having understood the meaning of it, but still, it seems to me that it did not answer the whole of my aspirations. Then you are aware I have for years past been swearing by the Bhagavad Gita, and I have said that it answers all my difficulties as being my Kamadeva, my guide, my open system on hundreds of moments of doubt and difficulty. I cannot recall a single occasion when it has failed me. But it is not a book that I can place before the whole of this audience. It requires a prayerful study before the Kamadenu starts yielding the rich milk she holds in her udders. But I have fixed upon one mantra that I am going to recite to you as containing the whole essence of Hinduism. Many of you, I think, know the Ishopanishad. I read it years ago with translation and commentary. I learned it by heart in Yarwada jail, but it did not then captivate me as it has done during the past few more months, and I have now come to the final conclusion that if all the Upanishads and all the other scriptures happened all of a sudden to be reduced to ashes, and if only the first verse in the Ishopanishad were left intact in the memory of Hindus, Hinduism would live forever. According to him, this is the essence of Hinduism. So of all the Upanishads, Ishopanishad stands first. Then Kenopanishad, Katopanishad, then so many, the Ishopanishads are there. But first comes the Ishopanishad. Now this mantra divides itself in four parts. First part is Ishavashyamidam Sarvam Yatkindya Jagatyam Jagam. It means, as I would translate, all this that we see in this great universe is pervaded by God. Then comes the second and third, which are read together as I read them. I divide these into two and translate them thus. And it ends there. There is another rendering which means the same thing. Enjoy what he gives you. Even so, you can divide it into parts. Magrida Prasasidvaram, which means do not covet anybody's wealth or possession. All the other mantras of that ancient Upanishad are a commentary or an attempt to give us the full meaning of the first mantra. As I read the mantra in the light of the Gita, or the Gita in the light of the mantra, I find that the Gita is a commentary on this mantra. It seems to me to satisfy the craving of all. I venture to suggest to all who do not belong to a Hindu faith that it satisfies their craving also. And if it is, I hold it to be true. You need not take anything in Hinduism which is inconsistent with or contrary to the meaning of this mantra. What more can a man in the street want to learn than this, that the one God and creator and master of all the life pervades the three other parts of the mantra? He goes on. Ishavashyamidam sarvam Yatkindya Jagatyam Jagad Yena Tyaktena Gunjira Madhurasthasyatisvaram. Those who know a little bit of Sanskrit will find that there is nothing abstruse here that you find in other Vedic mantras, and its meaning is simply this. All that is there in this universe, great and small, including the tiniest atom, is pervaded by God, known as Creator or Lord. Isha means the ruler. And he who is the creator, naturally by every right, becomes the ruler too. And here in this verse, the seer has chosen no other epithet of the deity but that of the ruler, and has accepted nothing from his jurisdiction. He says, everything that we see is pervaded by the deity. And from that, naturally, the other parts of the mantra follow. Thus he says, renounce everything. That is, everything that is on this universe, the whole of the universe, not only this tiny globe of ours, renounce it. He asks us to renounce it as we were such insignificant atoms that we had any idea of possession, it would seem ludicrous. And then says the Rishi, the reward of renunciation, the enjoyment of all you need. But their meaning about the word might actually say eat, etc., but means that you may not take more than necessary of your food. Therefore, this enjoyment or use limited by two conditions, on the act of renunciation, or the author of the Bhagavad Gita would say, enjoy the spirit, and every day morning. Everyone who believes in Bhagavad Dharma, this is the most important thing. Every day in the morning, everyone who believes in Bhagavad Dharma has to dedicate his thoughts, words and deeds to Krishna. Krishna is one of them. Krishna the indweller. No? And not until he has performed the daily act of renunciation, dedication of his thoughts, words and deeds, has he the right of touching anything, drinking even a cup of coffee. And when man has performed that act of renunciation and dedication, he derives from that act the right of eating, drinking, clothing, housing himself to the extent necessary for his daily life. Therefore, take it as you like, either in the sense that you enjoy, that the enjoyment or use is the reward of renunciation, or that the renunciation is the condition of enjoyment. Renunciation is essential for our very existence, for our soul. So we suddenly realize that nothing is ours. When we come to this earth, we don't bring anything. You came naked into this world, and you have to go back naked. You cannot take anything with you, and does not permit you to take anything with you when you go out of the world. During your short sojourn in this planet, the Lord allows you to enjoy freely of all the happiness created for you by Him. Why do we say that you have to dedicate? It is not that simply, no. Nothing is irrational. The simple thing is, when I come to this world, I don't bring anything. Everything, you know, there is not a single thing that I can say, I have brought it. In the form of not only objects of men, even the very emotion and thought. Now we are talking. It is because of the language. Did we create or produce this language? Nothing. Any object, because the air we breathe, the water we drink, the earth on which we stand, the space in which we move about, the 98.4 degree temperature that keeps us alive, have we brought anything? Ishavashyamidam sarvam. When he says the Lord pervades everything, he is the supreme owner of everything. He is not an entity. You will find in some other explanation, he is the power. Isha means power for him. The power that enables us to do the breathing now. Are we doing it? Can we stop? In Bhagavad Gita, everything is explained, you know, even the Aham Vaishvanaro Bhukta, you know, the power of digestion, the power of breathing, the power of blood circulation, the power of heartbeat. So, Ishavasya Midam Sarvam Sloga directly goes to the fundamental thing. I am what I am because of the factors other than me, which are provided by the power. Not only that power gave me a sense of individuality and brought me into this world, but power out of the love for this creation has provided everything. All the basic fundamentals plus all the comforts. What is needed for a comfortable life that has also been provided. It starts from this, you know, language, just imagine. So, as you say, Gandhiji says, as soon as we get up, first act should be dedicating our thought, word and deed to that power. Then, that is called renunciation here. That dedication is called renunciation here. In fact, it's a great renunciation. Because after they really do that, I cannot even for fun's sake say that I own this building. I own this laptop. I own this specs. I own this. I will not be able to say. He provided the cotton through a cotton plant. Through Mother Nature. He made one of his creation to go and see it. He kindled the curiosity in him. And somehow, you know, the cotton was removed from the pod. And then the carding, the so many things, you know, separating the cotton from the pod, then carding, and then thread, from the thread to the weaving section, so many, finally tailor and finally it has come to this stage. Through intelligence, you know. He is Buddha Buddhivadhamasmi. He is the intelligence, and the intelligence of the intellect, he says. You know. So through intelligence, though he provided the raw material through Mother Nature, the cotton, through the intelligent, persevering effort, through his chosen, selected instruments, he brought out this. When there was no specs in the world, he made somebody to conceive the specs. And now he again went through so many polishing, refining, and finally just come to this stage. When I eat, today we had our lunch. There is rice there, there is some dishes are there, there is a curd there. Suddenly you start remembering, God provided the paddy to Mother Nature and He made one of His creation to look at it. Why this? Somehow you are prompted to segregate the husk from which. And when he saw the rice there, again the curiosity, the pondering deep made him to research upon how to make use of this, and finally it has become a staple diet. You know? Anything, the chakras we wear, everything you can say, which is ours, that is, Gandhiji says, this is the fundamental factor. So we can enjoy after dedicating. As where somebody says, when God provided all this, God wanted all of us to enjoy His own. Everything is His. He did not want to keep it Himself. He has distributed to all of us. But unfortunately, we have mistaken study these hours. This is the creed. So when we go through inquest of God, when we go through attributes of God or any other thing or scripture like Upanishads or Bhagavad Gita, the most underlying principle is, Papa often used to say, you know, spirituality that cannot be applied in actual life is no spirituality. In daily life. So again, going back to some of the words of Gandhiji, with this background, we should try to understand. The very first verse of Ishopanishad means simply this. God pervades everything that is to be found in this universe, down to the tiniest atom. The mantra describes God as the creator, the ruler, the Lord. The seer to whom this mantra or verse was revealed was not satisfied with the magnificent statement that God was to be found everywhere. But he went further and said, since God pervades everything, nothing belongs to you, not even your own body. God is the undisputed, unchallengeable master of everything you possess. So when a person who calls himself a Hindu goes through the process of regeneration or second birth, he has to perform a dedication or this or renunciation of all that he has in ignorance called his own property. And when he has performed this act of dedication or renunciation, he is told that he will win a reward in the shape of God taking good care of what he will require for food, clothing and housing. Therefore, the condition of enjoyment or use of the necessaries of life is their dedication and renunciation. And that dedication or renunciation has got to be done from day to day. Lest we may in the busy world forget the central fact of life. And to crown it all, the seer says, covet not anybody's riches. I suggest to you that the truth that is embedded in this very short mantra is calculated to satisfy the highest cravings of every human being, whether they have reference to this world or the next. I have in my search of the scriptures of the world found nothing to add to this mantra. Looking back upon all the little I have read of the scriptures, this precious little I confess, I feel that everything good in all scriptures is derived from this mantra. If it is universal brotherhood, not only brotherhood of all human beings, but of all living beings, I find it in this mantra. If it is unshakable faith in the Lord and Master and all the adjectives you can think of, I find this in mantra. If it is the idea of complete surrender to God and of the faith that He will supply all that I need, then again I say I find it in mantra. Since He pervades every fiber of my being and all of you, I derive it from the doctrine of equality of all creatures on earth, and it should satisfy the cravings of all philosophical chemists. This mantra tells me that I cannot hold as mine anything that belongs to God. And if my life and that of all who believe in this mantra has to be a life of perfect dedication, it follows that it will have to be a life of continual service of our fellow creatures. This, I say, is my faith and should be the faith of all who call themselves kin. He has provided everything equally to all of us. And when even on anything and everything, we suppose we go back to the origin, we find it starts from Him. That's why He says, Ishavashyam Idam Sarvam. It is to understand that we are going through so many spiritual disciplines. Suddenly we remembered passage. The life principle that activates all being is the same. When, you know, suppose we are sick, when it is reported to a doctor, he brings along with him the Jiti definition. Jiti is the heartbeat. But if the circulation is alright, he will start scratching on the lower side of the foot. He will watch our breathing, he will take the pulse rate. 70 is supposed to be the average. These are all same enough. Same thing. Think about it. The basic factors of our very existence is exactly the same in everybody. This is what Prabhupada says. The life principle that activates all being is the same. We all breathe the same air, walk on the same earth, and are equally entitled to the enjoyment of the amenities which nature provides. The earth yields its rich gift to all alike. The difference between man and man on the material plane are in truth unnatural, improper. For, why so? The component parts and the composition of human bodies and the qualities inherent in them are not diverse and conflicting. According to one research of the scientists, there are about 200 odd organs in our body, no? Equal. Vital organs are same. And everybody is subject to birth, growth, decay, disease, death. For the component parts and composition of human bodies and the qualities inherent in them are not diverse and conflicting. If we look with the pure vision that belongs to an enlightened mind, we do not see any clear-cut line of demarcation that isolates man from man, one set of people from another, one nation from another. We are indeed parts of a stupendous whole. We are units that form the world community or a family. So we can live and act as members of a world brotherhood or federation. That's why Gandhiji said, you know, if you want to know something about world brotherhood, go to this. And in this connection, when we know that everything has come from him and everything is his, suppose we possess him, he becomes ours. Then everything also automatically becomes ours, you know. What do we do now? According to our faith, we pray for this and that. He is the owner of this entire universe, entire resources, entire thing. And we are asking, you know, in our petty mindedness, some insignificant trivial thing. So seers say, instead of asking for this and that, why don't you pray for making you aware of his? So that the moment he becomes yours, everything that is his becomes yours. That means you feel contented, you know, you feel fulfilled. Enjoy the possession of God, you know. This is what, you know, called God realization or self-realization or Kaivalya or Nirvana. Everything is the same. That God becomes, I become God's or God becomes mine. You know. Everything, it is already there, I become aware. Another interpretation, that was a very, we are always engrossed with the material world. We do not know truth, so we are constantly busy with falsehood. We are always engrossed with the delusion. Our Kundalini Shakti is not yet awakened, so we do not feel in our gross body that the powerful invisible body is always abiding within us. That invisible body is bound in the jungle of matter. That invisible body is the sole doer in every human being. We have no soul culture. Because we do not practice, which is the shortcut technique of cold culture. So we say, we always have ignorance within us. That is why every human being fails to understand that whenever he is seeing, hearing, smelling, touching, eating, talking, walking, doing, moving, enjoying, all is done by the power of God, that is Ishvara. For this reason, the Rishi first wrote, Ishavashyam idam sarvam, yatkindya jagatyantyagat. God Ishvara is the all-pervading. However insignificant something may be, it is He. Since we have no meditation, we cannot perceive, we cannot conceive, we cannot think, we cannot realize that whatever we are seeing or doing, it is only He, He is Ishvara. Ishvara is beyond us, beyond ignorance, beyond darkness, beyond falsehood. Only by meditation can we perceive it. You remember one chapter in Quest of God? What did that Ajmer said? Huh? Meditation is the only way. Huh? Only by meditation can we perceive it. That is by manana, by going within, by introvertedness, by inward inquiry. This cannot come from outside. So if you meditate, then in your every inhalation and every thought you can perceive that the power of God is always within you. Simple, you know, how does the breathing take place? Simple question. Suppose you say, now you stop breathing. Will it obey? And if it obeys, what happens? So if you meditate, then in your every inhalation and every thought you can perceive that the power of God is always within you. Whatever is there in the universe, land or property, jungle, creepers, trees, plants, animal beings, insects, any insignificant things which you are seeing, it is also Ishvara. The power of God. In your thoughts, whatever you feel or understand, whatever you imagine while mixing with a person, whatever you appreciate, you should perceive all these as the power of God, Ishvara. The power to think, you know. A dead body does not do that, no? So when the life force, God in the form of life force goes in, all these activities get triggered. You are born by the help of Ishvara. You are brought up by the help of Ishvara. And in the end, you will be merged in Ishvara. In this loga, it is written, Yatkindya Jagatyam Jagat. Jagat means that which is, no, jagatakataka. Yeah. That is not subject to change. Jagat means that which is born, which grows, develops, changes into various forms, takes a new shape. That is called Jagat. The so-called imperishable, no? We say, God is perishable, the other one is imperishable. Where from this imperishable has come? This imperishable is called Jagat. Jagat is its manifestation. We do not understand that Ishvara is all pervading, so we cannot perceive that this lifeless earth, water, fire, air, sky, birds, insects, man, grass, sand, dust, are also all-pervading Ishvara. So long as one does not have the power of meditation, one cannot perceive God. But when we seek deeply, then one day we will see that there is nothing in the universe which is not God. In all of the Upanishads, it is said that God first contemplated, then and that created the universe. In the creation, whatever we see, whatever we feel, whatever we imagine, that is the living presence of the soul. From one he has become many. In Aitreya Upanishad it is written that God was not feeling happy. He wanted to be many. After that he started creation. First he created the sky, the great void. From that sky the air was born. From the air, fire was born. From the fire, water was born. From the water, the earth was born. From the earth, the fungus was born. From fungus to the trees. From the trees to the seeds. From the seeds to the insects. From the insects to the animals. From the animals to the human being. Although there are so many forms, they are all the power of God, Krishna. How the chronology gets placed? Man eating the seed, you know, the creative power is inherent in him. And when that is to be a process of procreation, when it is done, human being is born. Bijamma Sarvabhutanam. We will again read that. In Aitira Upanishad it is written that God was not feeling happy. He wanted to be many. After that, he started creation. First, he created the sky. Sky means not the upper one, no? Here, sky is meant the great wall. Gagana Sadrisham. In which we are all sitting now.
Space.
That would be the right word. Space. So from the space, the air was born. From the air, fire was born. From the fire, water was born. From the water, the earth was born. From the earth, the fungus was born. Then from fungus to the trees. From the trees to the seeds. From the seeds to the insects. From the insects to the animals. From the animals to the human being. Although there are many forms, they are all the power of God, Ishvara. In the Bible, in Genesis, God said that He would take a handful of dust and make man after His own image. He took a handful of dust, breathed into the nostrils His own breath, and He became many in the whole world. In the Isha Upanishad, He said, not only the human being, but whatever insignificant thing may be in the world, it is I myself that is remaining there. In the Chandogya Upanishad, he said that the living God takes the form of an inanimate object. He created the sky, all the five elements, and by the help of this, He has created food grains, vegetables, drugs, fruit, which are also the living presence of the soul, Ishvara. From these grass, food grains, vegetables, milk, fruit, and other food products, Ishvara has given energy to every animal and human being. And through this energy, the animal and the human being are getting life force. Air is the principal requirement of every human being. Air means inhalation, which enters through the nostrils to the lungs, by which all living beings are alive. As there is cotton in the cloth, so inhalation is the life of every human being. The secondary requirement of every human being is food, water, and then fire. By the help of food, water and fire, the living can create, talk, walk, prana, life force, and mana, the mind. In the external world, we see various powers. In the internal world, this corresponds to our talk. In the external world, we see water, which in the internal world, is affection and love. In the external world, we see food. In the internal world, we get mind through food. Our thoughts come out in the form of Vak, Prana and Mana. We express our mind through talk. That is also Ishvara, the power of God. In the first sloka of Isha Upanishad, he said that the whole world that we perceive, what we conceive, what we feel, what we think, what we see, what we hear, what we taste, is all perceived by the power of Ishvara. The real meaning of the two words, Jagatyam Jagade, is that any perception, conception, will, thoughts, memory, particular sensations which are arising in any human being are also given by God. That is Ishvara. Any passion, anger, greediness, pride, vanity, ego, suspicion, viciousness, sorrow, fear are appearing in every human being also by the power of Krishna. Amritam jiva mrityushcha tadashcham Arjuna. The Lord says in Bhagavad Gita, O Arjuna, nectar, poison, falsehood and truth are all created by me, but evil propensities should be avoided. Ishvara and Parameshwara are two different things. There are 8 aspects of God, of which one power is called Ishvara, while Parameshwara is the unity of divine being. Tat sarvam bhavat, which means that he, Ishvara, becomes many. This is the quality of Ishvara. The next line of the first chapter of Ishvara is, Yena Tyaktyena Bujjida Madhrata Kasya Sujjanam. It means that you should enjoy everything in the divine manner. Since the power of Ishvara is within you, he is feeling appetite. Beautiful, this is. He is feeling appetite. We feel, I am hungry, no? Normally we say, he is feeling the appetite. Then he is also expressing his desire for lunch. This is also the power of God. Although the lunch is matter, yet the energy and power of God is there. You are seeing the lunch. Ishai, in a human form, is seeing the lunch on the table. It means that the seer and the seen are one. Seeing means being. Hearing means being. Knowing means being. Talking means being. Without the soul, Isha, one cannot see the lunch on the table. Man feeds the lunch of the living soul. Now the lunch is transformed into energy in the stomach. After that, the living man is getting strength in the whole body. By the help of this body, his eyes can see. The seer and seen are one. His ear can hear by the help of animate, inanimate food grains. His mouth can speak. Then the human being can feel that whatever he is doing, it is done by the inanimate external food grain, which is again the power of God. In the world there is such matter and many objects which we do not require, although they are a form of Isha. But when we feel the need of them, then we want to unify them with our soul, that is Isha. Without soul, we cannot enjoy it. Whenever we are going to enjoy, the desire comes from the soul. If we feel that the soul wants another inanimate form for the soul, then it is Yena Tyaktyena Bujjida. That is renunciation. Also, that is God perception. If in every enjoyment we feel that the soul is enjoying soul, that is real renunciation. I am not there to enjoy, no? The soul is enjoying. It's a new concept given to us, no? You all take 3 times or 4 times food a day, no? How he brings in this through this person's yoga. So when we say the time for lunch, immediately we should know he is reminding us for his food. So we take the plate, we keep go there. Every mouthful of food is an offering to him. Every morsel of food that we eat, where we put it in our mouth. That is why Gandhiji said every touch, you know. That is why he said this is the essence of Hinduism, you know. Then it was not clear. We were just hearing. Now he has opened up, you know. Because the life force is there, a dead body is there, it will not demand lunch, you know. Though he has, he is also there in a different form. Because everything is his. Even a dead body is his, you know. Then after the use, when we take, you know, banana is ripe, you take it, you peel off the skin, and the skin is thrown. Until such that at moment, the skin had its relevance to keep up the quality, huh? until you use, the quality is kept up because of the skin. And the moment it is ripe, then you take, you throw the skin out. Similarly, when it has ripened, he makes a few drops. He doesn't lose his significance. But what here is meant is that, he is now acting. He is behind his word. He is behind the movement of his hand. He is behind the movement of the eye. Now when we read, adorable person, we might be able to understand little more, no? Adorable person, the power. Thou who art within and without, above and below and all around, thou who art interpenetrating the very cells of our being, thou who art the eye of our eye, ear of our ears, heart of our heart, mind of our mind, breath of our breath, life of our life, and the soul of our soul. Bless us, dear God, to be aware of thy presence now and here. So my Ramnam chanting should enable me to constantly remember his presence. HCR. Okay, it becomes more and more clearer and clearer. His constant remembrance. Whether we remember him or not, he is there with us. So he has given us to a play field and he is watching us whether we remember him. Whenever we don't remember him and assert and assume that we are individuals, he allows us to play. But he patiently waits. And when it goes beyond certain level which he has fixed, he gives them back, calls them back, either by giving kicks and knocks, or by a sudden illumination through a saint, or something he makes it instrumental for us. As Pujya Swami Sityanji said, a trip way back to our own real home. This is spirituality in a nutshell. Whatever we do under the banner of spiritual discipline should ultimately resolve into this. Even the very act of prompting us to chant. Now you remember, Papa said two things you should be guarding against. One is that you are chanting the name of one who is seated within you. Number one, he is the one who is making you to chant. Same idea. Because later on, we will come to know he is the power behind chanting. He must be the power behind everything. My thinking, my seeing, my hearing. So the graduation takes place from that day on. So here renunciation means actually it's a wonderful word Gandhiji has given, you know. Renunciation we all thought, you know, it's a big word. How can the ordinary people do that? You have professional life, you have social life, you have family life, you have individual life. How can you be free from? No. You need not. Just to know that he is the owner. That's all. Just to keep on affirming that he is the owner. He is the ruler. He is seated within and he is seated without. Just like he is seated within, he is seated within everybody. So everybody is floating in. Everything. After reading this again, suppose we go back to the outpourings, it might become more and more clear now. when he, wherever he says Ram, suppose he says in Papa's own words, the mysterious power. And attribute this, everything will become clearer and clearer and clearer. But superb is his lunch, you know. None of us can avoid it on any day. But normally our tendency is, I feel hungry, you know. We used to read Aham Vaishvanaro book, you know. Also things we read, but we don't mean. Because of the Vaishvanara, he is there in the form of Vaishvanara. You feel, no, the belly is empty and you need some food. Because when we go to the doctor, will prescribe, you know, two times this you take, with that you take, this you take. So we stay at this level. We don't see the other level. Right from childhood, you know. Eating has started or drinking has started the moment he came to this world. When Gandhiji said, if we read this mantra in the background of Gita, or Gita in the background of mantra, it becomes very clear. Yeah, everything, all these things are there in the Bhagavad Gita. But this sloka only reminds us. He tells everything there. Even the aushadhi, even the, you know, how does a bitter gourd become bitter? How does a sugar cane become sweet? How does a chili become hot, spicy? How does a tamarind become sour? Or, like that, you know. You start thinking. So what all he has made so that we don't feel monotony, you know? Boredom, drudgery, all those things will be there if the same thing is served. Ishavashyam sarvam yatindiyajagatyajagat. So Papa wanted all of us to apply our mind on this particular mantra. Go deeper and deeper and deeper into it. Because it contains in a small capsule the entire spiritual damage. Where can I place my feet? Is there? Do I exist apart from him? So that can be known only through meditation. That will be maybe the point. If we keep our eyes open and start seeing it, you will be seeing it as an object. But with a mind trained, with a mind churned, that it has come from him, then it gets a different, the mat. We will not throw it now, no? Somewhere in the heart we know that he is there in that form. So there will be a touch of love in handling anything and everything. Raw materials have been provided. The know-how, intelligence has been provided. Both are provided by him. In Vedanta language, they call it as, you know, material cause and then efficient cause, efficiency cause, intelligence. You have before you the mud. That is the material cause. But the efficiency cause is there. It is because of that, you know, the prompting comes to make it as a pot. So both these things are done. So he has given us all the raw material. He has given us the intelligence and he has brought about everything by his combination.
He has brought about the finished product also.
Yeah? Finished product, yeah.
Finished product. Intelligence.
Ah, correct. All fruits and vegetables are finished products, you know. If we just open, cut open anything, you find the beautiful way in which everything is arranged there. How the seeds are arranged in a fruit. Layer by layer, how meticulous care has been taken to bring it out. whether it is bindi, whether it is bean, whether it is this or that. Anything that you, suppose you make a surgery, the wonderful way in which everything has been so beautifully arranged. You open the anar, you know. Pearls, like pearls. Jackfruit. Anything, you know, anything. Everything is unique. What a beautiful setup, you know. Super architect is he, that he has brought it out in different ways. And everywhere he has ensured that he, as individual, I will get bored if I see the same thing, you know, if I taste the same thing. So one day it will be idli, another day it will be dosa, a third day it will be upma. You see that, no?
Yes.
Same material. But with intelligence you make, with intelligence, the drudgery, boredom and all those things are answered. It's a serious subject. So behind everything he is there, you know, which we are trying to understand through Swadhyay, through Namjaba, through Bhajan, through Darshan, through pilgrimage. But this we forget, that he is always with us. So when I feel thirsty, when I feel hungry, suddenly I can bring this food. Then it can disrupt the breathing. Then it can disrupt the first beat. Then it can disrupt the circulation. You are there. Like that, you know. And finally, he will say from within. Who is now questioning? Who is thirsting now?
What do you say? Papa is hungry.
Papa beats hungry, but we will forget Papa while eating. Give me more. Two more dosha. You remember, there is a word in Papa, he says, eat without tasting. Remember?
Yes.
Look without seeing. Hear without listening. Eat without tasting. That can come now it's clear. It can come only when we detach, you know, the sense of individuality detaches and God is taking me in. Don't disturb it now. Everything has come down to these rituals, no? Even in many of the ashram, before they take food, they chant the 15th chapter. Because they are the Vaishnavas who come
there.
Only to remind that, but we do it as a ritual. We have no connection. The person is I am eating at all. Because this has not been explained to him, no? So he is eating, you facilitate everything, you watch, you serve it. It's the toughest job, agree. But the more, at least after eating, we can think about it, no? During the time of eating, it may not be possible right now. But after eating over time, though at that time you made me to forget about you, but now I know that you are satisfied. And then, now then you connect up. When he said day for yesterday, what are the sattvic food? There, no? He connects up.
Oh,
time is over. But still we will read this particular portion of food. That would increase vitality, power, strength, health, happiness and peace. This food is tasteful, pure, invigorating and pleasant. Rajasic, you know, bitter, sour, saltish, hot, pungent, insipid, fiery, causes pain, sorrow. And the other one, tamasic, cold, tasteless, rotten, nauseating, stale, dirty. Yes. So here, now when we know that we have been given a freedom, you know, freedom to think that we are serving. Though ultimately everything is done by Him. Out of His generosity, He has given us a sense of freedom by which we can know that we are facilitating it. Every one of us have to think and bring out this. You are without me, you cannot be without me, I cannot be without you. You remember that word. No? You are in my custody, He is in my custody. You are dependent upon me, I am dependent upon you. That means, though both of us are, Ram and Ramdas are one, while giving the sense of individuality to Ramdas, or an individual, all of us, He is giving us the freedom to serve Him, to know Him, you know, to become aware of Him, and then dedicate everything to Him. So these are all some of the points which need lot of manana, lot of manana. Every time when we take a plate, a pencil, anything you know we handle, we may fail, we may forget, but we must try now, try now, try now. Ishavashyavidam sarvam. That particular word, Gandhiji, you know, the tracker. Everywhere, in everything. Even when I go to the lavatory, when I use the commode, when I open the tap, close the tap, nothing is irrelevant, nothing is unimportant, nothing is insignificant. Nobody is irrelevant, nobody is unimportant, nobody is insignificant. Slowly all these words become more and more clearer and clearer to us. All with the help of this one word, Ishavashyavidanta. That is your vita. Unless and until this churning goes on inside, you will not be able to take full advantage of it. Meditation is the only way it is. Because this cannot come from anything outside. It's an inner revelation. Meditation is not sitting and going to the genesis of everything, going to the origin of everything, going to the source of everything, and immediately we find we are also floating from the source only. Nothing else but me. So let's all try to. We are deeply grateful to Papa for having facilitated us to do this fundamental factor, fundamental point. And He prepared us, probably, have we read this? 3 months back, you would not have. He prepared us by going through His impression God. He prepared us through certain things through Adhyasita God. And then only He introduced His Ishavashyavidanta. You see the way in which things are arranged. So now we must make this. And every standard when we go up and up from third to fourth, fourth to fifth, fifth to sixth, you know, and when we write +1, +2, then go to the college. The preparation is to be done. Suddenly we realize we all go for lunch, we all go for dinner, we all go for breakfast. We keep waiting for the coffee or tea, you know. But now we are doing, we have demanded from inside, I'll wait for it, you know, to give coffee and breakfast. See the beautiful truth. This is not the relationship of our meditation. Every time we refer, He is there, no? He wants it. He would like to have the bath. you would like to get just see the difference. So we will not throw our dress like this. We press the shirt or your clothes, or we hold it nicely and keep it. Tomorrow you are going to use it. But still, now you know, the puja, how much is what, reverence we offer everything. Same thing should be done to him. Same thing should be, so the word dedication, kindly. Keep on churning with that word. Dedication of everything. So there is no me and mine. You will find in the end of the first chapter of Inquest of God, this is there. The me and mine was receding, he said. Ram covering up. Remember? The last line of the first chapter. It was at this time that it slowly dawned upon his mind that Ram was the only reality and all else was false. While desires for the enjoyment of worldly things were fast falling off, the consideration of me and mine was also wearing out. The sense of possession and relationship was vanishing. All thought, all mind, all heart, all soul were concentrated on Ram. Ram covering up, absorbing everything. Isha Vashim Dhamita. You have facilitated so many things for us. Now kindly make it a reality in our life. That is the only way. 100% we are all intellectually convinced. Now make it a reality. So that the me and mine doesn't come on and then take possession of it. Every time when it comes, please give a knock. Make it to sit down. So that no, it will not come and roll. Isha Vashya Midan Sarva. Let us all do this. More of it than the average mark. Om Shri Ram. Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram,
Jai Ram, Jai
Jai
Ram, Jai Ram, Jai
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram,